The title of my presentation says I will be speaking about the structural remodeling of human skeletal muscle with chronic loading and unloading. And perhaps before entering the specific topic, I'd like to emphasize the work, the seminal work, done in the 70s and 80s by Geoffrey Goldspink and Pamela Wilson. This work is exemplary in respect of showing the great plasticity of skeletal muscle. Basically, they... Oh, sorry. Basically, what they did, they counted sarcomeres number as a function of development of the animal. Oh, sorry. And as you can see, obviously, as the animal grows, sarcomeres are quickly added to make up for the elongation of bones. Once the animal reaches an adult stage, sarcomere addition stops. If the, the limb is immobilized in a stretched position, sarcomeres are added. When the cast is removed, sarcomeres are lost, returning to the original functional length. If instead the muscle is immobilized in a shortened position, sarcomeres are quickly lost. Again, once the cast is removed, sarcomeres return to the functional length. Instead, if we immobilize your muscle in the very early stages, growth is impaired. Once the sarcomere is removed, the sarcomeres are quickly added, returning to the original length, to the original functional length. This work was done in the 70s and 80s, but since the introduction of ultrasound, it is now possible, of course, to do these measurements in vivo. And perhaps the pioneer of this work is Professor Fukunaga. And in 1968, he was the first to show, using ultrasound, that there was a straight relationship between muscle cross-sectional area and muscle strength. Of course, this was also known for animal muscle, but in human muscle, he was the first to show this relationship, and this is the original picture obtained in 1968. Later on, of course, we all know that he published hundreds of papers, and one of the also seminal papers he produced together with Professor Kawakami is the, was concerning the pennation angle of bodybuilders. He found that as muscle hypertrophies, the fascicle pennation angle increases dramatically. And this is because the length of the aponeurosis is fixed, and the only anatomical way we can pack up more contractile tissue is by increasing pennation angle. So in reading this observation, then I started to wonder, this was at the very early of my career, I started to wonder what were the changes induced instead of training, during detraining. So we took patients that had a fracture of the lower limb, and so we measured the cross-section area of the uninjured limb and the injured limb. As you obviously would expect, there was a decrease in an anatomical cross-section area, but this decrease was accompanied by a decrease in pennation angle and a decrease in fascicle length measured by ultrasound. So, so we have the diametrically opposite situation, again illustrating plasticity. You know, the fascicles become shorter and less pennate. And next, of course, we wanted to know the time course of these events. And I spoke with Professor Michael Rennie of Nottingham University, and I proposed in this study, and of course this study was run by one of my PhD students, Martin de Boer. And so what he did, he got volunteers to walk on crutches for 3 weeks on this trendy shoe. So one foot is raised, one leg is suspended, and they did so for 3 weeks. And of course we measured muscle cross-sectional area using MRI of the calf muscle, and sorry, the quadriceps, and pennation angle using ultrasound. So what we see, as we would expect, cross-sectional area decreases very rapidly, we took measurements at 14 and 21 days at a rate of about 0.4% per day. But what was interesting to note that even after just 14 days, we could detect a decrease in fascicle length and a decrease in pennation angle. So these changes are very rapid. So if you remove the mechanical loading, there must be some organelles that are sensitive to mechanical loading. So we started to wonder, you know, what is the regulator of this decrease in sarcomere length and fascicle length. And so we have to look at specific integrins that are sensitive to mechanical loading. And these are one of these is focal adhesion kinase. Focal adhesion kinase here is transsarcolemma proteins, which is sensitive to mechanical loading, which places in relation the sarcomere to the extracellular matrix via chain of cytoskeletal proteins. What happens when you overload the muscle, the content and phosphorylation of FAK focal adhesion kinase increases, and if you decrease loading, we were wondering what happened. And so when we took muscle biopsies in these individuals that were hindlimb suspended for 3 weeks, we found that just after 10 days of unloading, there was a 30% decrease in phosphorylation of FAK and a 20% decrease in content. So a very fast decrease. But of course, the next question was, is this decrease in FAK related to the decrease in muscle mass? So is there a link between FAK and protein synthesis? And so the hypothesis was FAK was controlling protein synthesis. And of course, Martin Flück, proposed through several observations that FAK is able to stimulate protein synthesis through an independent pathway, which is parallel to the canonical mTOR-AKT pathway. And this is through X6 kinase. So to see the effect on protein synthesis, we took muscle biopsies. Before we flooded the muscle with a stable isotope, in this case labeled proline, and we took biopsies at 10 days and 21 days. And this is what we found. This is fractional rate of protein synthesis as a function of days of mobilization. This work was done at Derby, where Professor Michael Rennie and his team worked for many years. And of course, nowadays, the work of Professor Rennie is carried on by Phil Atherton, Paul Greenough, and the team. And as the days of immobilization progressed, protein synthesis was dramatically decreased by 50% just after 10 days of unloading. Of course, protein synthesis is one factor that contributes to muscle wasting. It is in healthy subjects, it is probably the most important factor, but we cannot also neglect protein breakdown. And after 10 days, there was indeed an increase in one of the atrogenes, MRF1. So also protein activation shows a transient increase after 10 days. Next question we wanted to address is what happens instead when we overload the muscle. We were interested in the speed with which muscle remodeling occurs with overloading. So we trained subjects, healthy subjects, with isoinertial training. They were doing contraction against flywheels for 35 days. We measure muscle cross-sectional area with MRI, and we use ultrasound to measure the quadriceps fascicle length and pennation angles. The classical ultrasound image, you can see the fascicles. We can measure the length and the pennation angle. And this is what we found during this 35 days training study. What was interesting to note was the time course of changes. Of course, we expected hypertrophy And we were wondering how early does hypertrophy occurs? Well, if we base our understanding of hypertrophy as an increase in cross-section area, you can see there is a very small, non-significant increase after 10 days. The increase starts to be significant after 20 days. And of course, after 35 days, it's even greater. But what's most interesting to note was that fascicle length increased at an even greater, to an even greater extent, and much earlier. An increase in fascicle length could be detected just after 10 days of overloading and carried on as training went by. And so did pennation angle. So this introduced a new concept that when we think of muscle hypertrophy, we have to think how sarcomeres are added. We can add sarcomeres in series or in parallel. In these cases, the increase in muscle volume is identical, but so we can obtain the same increase either by adding sarcomeres in series or in parallel. And what our data suggests is that with this type of training, the addition of sarcomeres in series is faster than the addition of sarcomeres in parallel, as reflected by an increase in pennation angle. And of course, the addition of sarcomeres in series is reflected by an increase in fascicle length. The next question we wanted to address is were the adaptations to concentric and eccentric loading. You all know that muscle force is a function of its velocity of contraction. Force decreases, our velocity increases, and if we go on negative velocities, force increases, increasing more and more so. And the maximum eccentric force in vivo is about 20% higher than the isometric force. So when we actually train with loads in a gym, what we're doing all the time is performing a concentric action, lifting a load, and then lowering the same absolute load. So it is shown here. So there is a concentric phase. This is the movement, the angular displacement of the knee. So a concentric phase and an eccentric phase. If we look at the EMG, of course, EMG increases during the lifting of the load. But in order to lower the load, we must forcibly de-recruit motor units. Because if we don't de-recruit motor units, the load stays there. So effectively, we are not using the potential or the force-velocity relationship, because we know that during the eccentric phase, we can produce about 20% more force than the isometric phase, and even more so than the concentric phase. So the concept is that if you look at the force-velocity relationship, by definition, every point of the force-velocity relationship belongs to a set level of neural activation. If you decrease neural activation, you jump on a lower force-velocity relationship. So what happens when you train? So you lift, say you're working at 75% of the repetition maximum. This is your concentric force. So if you were to exploit the force-velocity relationship, you would have to increase the load to travel on the same force-velocity relationship. But effectively, what we do, we de-recruit motor units, and we lower the load, and we jump on this curve. So we are not using the advantage that the force-velocity relationship gives us with eccentric training. So to overcome this obstacle, we purposely fitted a training machine with a winch so that one subject could do only concentric or only eccentric contraction. So we recruited two groups of people. This work was done by Martino Franchi at that time in one of my collaborators in Nottingham, in Manchester. Then he moved to Nottingham. And of course, so they were, the subjects were training concentrically with this load, and the group that trained eccentrically was training with this load, so about 20% higher. we measured pennation angle and fascicle and fascicle length with ultrasound, and we used MRI to measure muscle cross-section area. And what we found was that the increase in muscle volume was similar between the concentric and eccentric training, but was very different was the architectural adaptation. You can see that the group trained eccentrically increased fascicle length, but it showed very little increase in pennation angle, whereas the group that trained concentrically increased very much the pennation angle, but did not show a significant increase in fascicle length. So it looks as if that concentric and eccentric training lead to different architectural adaptations. So I'm trying to schematize this concept in this slide that shows a muscle before hypertrophy, and with hypertrophy, fascicles, you can see, become longer. This is mostly afforded by eccentric training. So in order to become longer, we are adding sarcomeres series. At the same time, pennation angle is increasing. It's increasing because we are adding sarcomeres in parallel. And so whereas concentric training tends to favor the addition of sarcomere in parallel by increasing pennation angle, eccentric training seems to increase to favor the addition of sarcomeres in series instead. Now, if since this occurs, it must be driven by different molecular mechanisms. So different molecular switches. So Martino Franchi, again, in my lab, he took muscle biopsies, and we looked at specific MAP kinases that we know that are responsive to cellular stress and that are responsible for cellular proliferation and differentiation, and which have in the animals have been shown to be contractions specific. And so we found that the group that trained eccentrically showed an increase in the phosphorylation of P38 in P90 RSK and also ERK12. So there seems to be different molecular switches switched on by concentric and eccentric loading. And these are not the same. Lastly, we in Derby, together with Phil Atherton, Paul Greenough, and again, the study was run mostly by Martino Franchi, we looked at the time course of muscle remodeling in young and elderly people during 8 weeks, medium intensity, long, high volume exercise at 60% of the 1RM. Again, we measure fascicle length and pennation angle, and this time we took measurements every 2 weeks. They trained for 8 weeks, and you can see that the fascicle length increased dramatically and very fast indeed. An increase in fascicle length could be detected just after 2 weeks of training and carried on throughout the training, and so both in the young and the elderly. This increase was much greater, of course, for the eccentric training compared to the concentric training. There was almost no significant increase. So again, we see that there is a different architectural response to concentric and eccentric. And as far as pennation angle, again, we saw that this increased with concentric training, both in young and elderly, but not in not with eccentric training. And as far as muscle cross-sectional area, so the muscle hypertrophy, we saw that, interestingly, we saw that there was a greater increase in cross-section area, both in the young and in the elderly subjects, afforded by eccentric training. Now, why should this be the case? Why should there be a difference between the response of the elderly and the young? Well, we know that when we train elderly, when we exercise elderly people, they have they reach a maximum increase in protein synthesis at 60% of the 1RM. Instead, young people show an increase in protein synthesis at 75% of the 1RM. This has been shown by Kumar, again in Derby. Also, it has been shown that moderate intensity, long duration exercise is very effective in overcoming metabolic resistance, which is commonly found in elderly people. So this kind of exercise seems to be particularly effective, as the results show, in elderly people, in inducing muscle hypertrophy in elderly people. We are now extending these measurements using extended field of view ultrasound, which I'm sure also Anthony Blazevic will talk about. He has a very extensive experience on this, because we're interested to know the regional adaptations induced by concentric and eccentric training in different regions of the muscle. So to summarize the results, I hope I've been able to show you the fast, that the skeletal muscle shows a fast remodeling response to both chronic loading and unloading, that changes in muscle mass with this condition are regulated by mechano-transductory proteins such as focal adhesion kinase, which acts as an upstream modulator of protein synthesis. Also, I think I showed you that the additional sarcomeres in a muscle in response to chronic overloading seems to follow a direction which is dictated by contraction mode. And lastly, we've seen a distinct signaling pathway controlling this differential muscle growth and being found to be activated by concentric and eccentric loading. I'd like to end by thanking all the colleagues that collaborated to these findings, both in Derby, in Zurich, in Padova, and also in Oslo, because one of my colleagues, now Olivier Senes, is in Oslo. Thank you very much.